Solomon, in Proverbs 8, decides to call us to something very special. I will read it in the New Living Translation, and I will not read the entire text. I'll just jump, and I have written some thoughts down. Brother Lazar said that he has a very special topic, which was tonight, the rarity, or rugăciunea care se face rară, no? Sau, cum a fost fraza? Rugăciunea rară. Asta e o chemare superioară, nu superioară la rugăciune, superioară în esență. This is a call of the superior call of wisdom, Proverbs 8. We're in 2019, and we have to engage. Taking my daughter to school every morning, she's 8 and a half, she's like almost a teenager, behaves like in most days. She asked me one day, what are those letters on the automatic on my car? And every day is a new topic, and that was a topic this week for one day. I go, well, this is that. When I said this is neutral, she simply asked, what is neutral? She's always in gear. She doesn't know what neutral means in her life. So she naturally asked, what is neutral? I don't get what that means. I go, you know, it's kind of like, it's very interesting. It means you're not engaged. And she goes, oh, what do you mean? It's not married? I'm like, okay, you're too young to talk about marriage, first of all, but let's get back to the transmission. So here's the engine, is the transmission. And the engine works, but unless the transmission engages, you have nothing as far as movement. And it occurred to me that we are many times stuck in neutral. We may know a lot, we may observe a lot, we may even interpret a lot, but when it comes to applying, we may say, oh, I'm not sure. So wisdom calls, and I would like to, by the ability that God gives me, is to pull us to some action in 2019 so that we are not only observing everything around us, which we are masters of, not only interpreting, which only the Spirit of God helps us interpret properly, may we do that so, but we may apply in our lives that which God wants us to do in 2019. It was your church again. I have so many fond memories that I shouldn't talk about that because I won't finish until 8. But of your church and of this wonderful, special place, at the 10th year anniversary, you guys had many guests, and I believe you had a week-long service because I came to a couple of them. And I remember one pastor had a little Bible like this, and I said, I want to be that guy with a little Bible that opens and reads and teaches, and I was not yet a preacher. It was Peter Lasco. And one of the things that I remember from his sermon, it says Americans, and now he was very general, and I don't want to necessarily say that what he said is perfect, but it was very good for me at the time. Romanians wake up to observe the world, to see what has changed, to see what's different. And he says Americans wake up with a different attitude. They wake up to change the world. And I was a young man learning the American culture saying, you know what, that's true. And I want to be both. I want to observe the world properly so I don't do anything foolish. But I want to be the one that changes the world so I don't be the one that's stuck in neutral, you know, that has that engine revving and that transmission ready, but I just don't know if I'm going to engage at all. In other words, I want to get married to the thoughts of God, to the wisdom of God, so that when we engage with the Spirit of God today through his text, may God call us to action that we may not just engage, but like Colby said, marry the very thing that God wants in our lives so that we are now a different person, different church, different group of people. So let's read from Proverbs 8, and it says as follows. Listen as wisdom calls out. Hear as the understanding raises her voice. And now it tells us where wisdom calls out. Let me just simply say, in our world, many voices call out. Many voices have different followers. For example, if I say, listen how Dana White calls you to the next best UFC fight, there's a lot of people that subscribe to that, and they'll listen. Like, what does he have to say? Because somehow some people love that. Listen how this guru of finances will speak, Warren Buffett or whoever. And people will listen and pay money to listen as he calls out because money is important to many. And as he says, we will go. Listen as Oprah recommends a book. I don't know, where can I go with this? I can tell you 1,000 voices that will call us out to listen. And what Oprah says, everybody reads, right? Or at least it was the case. Listen as, and we tune into all the channels and all the people and all the greats. And it's okay to observe everything in our world. We must be informed. But today it's a superior call because it says, listen as wisdom calls out, and listen and watch how wisdom prepares herself to be heard. It says, on a hilltop along the road, no matter what the road is, above and beyond, somewhere in those hilltops, and we have plenty in California. It feels like New Zealand right now with the green grass everywhere. We live in New Zealand for about 3 weeks or more. It's beautiful. All those hilltops, whenever you drive and you see a hilltop, think of wisdom on top of that hilltop, calling down to you and I, listen, I have something to ask you. I'm going to ask you to engage in this world. She takes her stand at the crossroad. And that's the most dangerous spot. You guys know this. When you drive, it's more dangerous than the freeway. It's the intersection. It's where people cross, where they bump and grind. It's if you walk the streets, is that's where you get, you know, trampled if there's a stampede. Or I don't want to go too far with this, but she takes her stand at the crossroads where there's a lot of traffic and a lot of people. Every hilltop, every road, every crossroad, wisdom begs to be heard, and yet we live in a world that ignores the superior call. By the gates at the entrance to the town, on the road leading in, she cries aloud. It's a very purposeful call. I will call to you, and this is the beauty of God's call. It's to everyone. It says, I call to all of you. I raise my voice to all the people. The simple, the ignorant says, you simple people, use good judgment. You foolish people, even those that would rebel against God, the sinful and the vile, show some understanding and listen. It may do you an eternal good, eternal change. Listen to me, for I have important things to tell you. Wisdom qualifies herself. Says, I have a couple of things to say. So first of all, it says, I have important things to say. And I'm going to put them all together in a list because I already speculated from the text. Important things to say. What I say is right. It is true. It is wholesome. It is enduring wealth. It is riches. It is honor. It is justice. It is plain. It's clear. It's common sense. It's insight. It's strength. This is wisdom. Why would we not listen? I hate deception, it says. Nothing devious and nothing crooked comes from me. What a beautiful source to listen to, right? You tell me anything in this world that comes close to that. Anything. You will find deception and spin and political BS everywhere, right? Excuse the expression. We live in a very vile world. But listen, I have it all, wisdom says, and it claims it as her own. And it continues. My words, these things that I share with you, this is verse 10. Choose my instruction rather than silver, knowledge rather than pure gold. Wisdom is far more valuable than rubies. As a matter of fact, it equates it to this. It is more important and more valuable, more of anything. Nothing you desire, nothing you would want can compare to it. When you're young, you want to be strong. When you're old, you want to be healthy. When you're, you name it, you want to be what you're not, right? And wisdom says, I have something greater than all that. Nothing you desire, nothing you can muster up to ask compares to what I have to offer. In other words, even our best requests, even our best intentions, even our best capacities as human beings, we go before God and we say, this is my bucket list of things that I need and I want and I would like to be. And he says, that's not enough because wisdom has more. Nothing that you desire can compare with wisdom, with what I have. Which means we have to not only observe the world we live in, not only interpret the world and the world as the word as we read it, but we have to apply. And the application in this particular passage means stop and recognize that what God wants to offer and trust that what God wants to offer is far superior than anything we can muster up to ask, request, imagine, beg for, need. And that's just a qualifier of wisdom. Now we move on. I'm not going to read that. I'm going to go back to verse or jump to verse 22. And now wisdom, that was the introduction saying, you know, this is what I do. This is who I am. This is what I can offer. It's a very superior call, right? And now it gives a little bit of background to who wisdom is and where wisdom came from. In the scientific world, which seems to be the world which most people refer to when they want to be smart, or if they want to quote something, they quote the smarts of the world. It's like quoting Einstein on riding bikes. What does that have to do with anything, you know? Like, Einstein's smart in whatever he was doing, theoretical physics, but riding bikes, eh. You know, but we quote experts, and the experts tell us all. And the experts look back in history, or they look back in our appreciable world, and they realize there's a time when we don't know nothing about. It's dark. And that's where false teachings come in schools and everywhere, where people, they believe there's something that came of that. Well, wisdom says, I was there. Watch, it says, the Lord formed me from the beginning. Before the Lord formed anything, verse 22, else, I was appointed in ages past, at the very first, before the earth began. I was born before the oceans were created, before the springs bubbled forth their waters, before the mountains were formed, before the hills were born, I was born. Before he made the earth and the fields and the first hand fists of soil, I was there. And that's not enough to just be there as an observant. I was there when he established the heavens, the eternity, which is to us so big we can't comprehend. When he drew the horizon on the ocean so that water is perfectly flat, so you have a nice, perfect horizon. I was there when he set the clouds above, so we have rain and we have billions of gallons coming upon us. How does it float? That's wisdom. I was there. And when he establishes the spring, so deep within we have water, even when we don't have rain in the earth. I was there when he set the limits of the sea so that they would not spread beyond their boundaries. And we are always informed with fear that our oceans will rise. Antithesis to what wisdom says. Wisdom says they will not, because God has limits, and he created those limits. When he marked off the earth's foundations, I was the architect at his side, not only an observer, but the wisdom was involved in building. I was his constant delight. You're beginning to appreciate who wisdom is, right? Rejoicing always in the Creator's, in his presence. Oh, how happy I was when the world was created. How do we approach the world God created? How do we approach the work of God? Because this is, we're observing from the text, we're going to interpret, and then we have to apply it. Wisdom says, I was there, I was part of it, I was part of his work, and I was happy when he made whatever his mind decided to make, God's mind. And how happy I was, how I rejoiced with the, verse 31, with the human family. How I rejoiced with the human family, with the, it doesn't say the human Adam or Eve, but the family, the idea of God bringing forth people in his plan with people from A to Z. And that's the second part, wisdom saying, I was at the origin, I was part of the origin, I was the origin, I was there, I was architect. So I'll apply this in a little bit. In the last part, part three, so the first part was the wisdom who has the call for everyone, and it qualifies why you want to listen to her, because there's riches and there's imaginations that you don't have that God can fulfill. There's silver, gold, rubies, don't compare, important things, right things, true things, the very things that are most important wisdom has, and the call is that important. It's for everyone. The second part was how wisdom says, I was at the origin, I am the essence of everything that was. I was there, and I rejoiced. And the third part is now it comes to us, and now it's the applicability. Verse 32. How wonderful that wisdom would call us her children. And so, my children, listen to me. So it was the call for everyone, including the foolish and the simple. And now it turns to a small body, which tonight happens to be us. And I don't mean small like your church is small. I mean small compared to the rest of the world. The ones that would hear. Now listen, my children. For all who follow my ways are joyful. I thought the world's going to end. Well, it is, but God's plan taken to completion will bring joy, not fear. I followed a guy, very intelligent old man. He's from Norway, and he said, why are all these scenarios with weather change and climate change, why are they always doomsday? Why do they say that whatever changes is going to be for the worse? What if it's for the better? Simple thought. What if that 0.8 degree increase in temperature makes the world a more pleasant place? How about that? Why don't they sell, maybe it's better? Well, because fear sells, and fear is powerful because you can control masses, multiple masses. When you have somebody in your hands and they fear, you have them for good. We know fears of the devil. Wisdom says, I bring and listen to my ways and I'll guarantee joy, right? That's the antithesis to fears, the idea of being free and being responsible. All who follow my ways are joyful. Listen to my instructions and be wise. Do not ignore it. Verse 34. Joyful are those who listen to me, watching for me daily at my gates, waiting for me outside my home. For whoever finds me finds life and receives favor from the Lord. But those who miss me injure themselves. All who hate me love death. Let's talk a little bit about this. It starts off with wisdom being everywhere, calling to everyone. And the calling is great, and there's much to offer. It ends up with an applicability, with asking us to say, please, my children, listen and start searching for me. Notice how it says, joyful are those who listen to me and watch for me at my gates. It's not a matter of just driving carelessly, haplessly down the road and listening for wisdom from atop a rooftop as it comes and downloads in your life. That's the beginning. That's what God does to bring people to himself. And once you're engaged in that, to make the committal, to make the marriage, to make it work, wisdom says to make that joy come alive, now watch for me daily at my gates. Put yourself daily, not waking up to see how the world has changed, but waking up to see how and what God is trying to do in the world. Remember, wisdom was the architect as God was forming. So if God is working something new in the church or in the world or in our society, and he is, let us be part of that. Wake up daily and see what God wants to do and say, Lord, I want to be part of that. I want the joy that comes with serving in your plan. Oh, yes, the temperature may climb or it may not, right? I had friends that are in the polar vortex. So did you guys. And now Portland and Oregon, they have, what is it, Snowmageddon, they call it? Are we going to pay attention to the weather? Sure, if we want to do that, we can. It's observing, right? And if we observe these facts like everybody else, let's go further and have wisdom help us interpret these facts. And if you look in the book of Job, God calls Job to say, observe the weather, sure. But know that I made it all. Know that every lightning bolt does what I say it should do. Know that every cloud moves and everything that comes is from my storehouse. And God may give or not whenever he wants to. So the weather is in his hands. And I'll tell you a story here. I was a young man in college and my professor, I remember him to this day because I love stories and his story told a lot. I may have forgotten the physics he taught, but the stories I did not. He said there was a professor named John Dalton back in the day, 1801, 1802, I forget the exact date. And this man woke up every day because he wanted to make some significant change in his life, in the world. He was meteculous about gathering the meteorological changes in the weather in England. And as you probably know, the weather in England is all over the place, right? It's foggy, it's cold, it's rainy. So for 30 years, meticulous scientific observations, 30 years of work. And he finally took this work, put it in, I would imagine, leather-bound or some sort of bound books, went to the society, the London Society that they had at the time, gave him the books, and who was in charge at the time, I forget, he told me the name, but I did forget who it was, looked at his work and said, rubbish, threw it out, junk, we can't use it. They knew that back then. Nowadays, we'd be like, ooh, you're a smart one, you know? Nowadays, the weather seems to preoccupy us more than back then. This is rubbish. 30 years of observation is great. That's the past. We don't know. We can't predict tomorrow, can we? But what came of this man is at one point he had a sign of wisdom. He had a thing that just out of the blue came to him, and we would say out of the blue, but we would say from God, because anything worthy of admiration and worth on this planet is from God. And he realized that compound, or rather elements, mixed together in definite proportions. H2O, two H's, one O. How simple is that thought? How could he have even thought about it if God wouldn't have given it to him, right? So 30 years of observations of human effort were rubbish in the eyes of his peers, and nobody knows where the papers are. But one thought from God, one moment of wisdom, one moment of divine interjection in our society gave him the ability to come up with this thing that elements in God's world, in God's wise world, right, they get pieced together in definite proportions so that we can have the modern branch of pharmacology or anything when it comes to medicine. Can you see how simple that idea is? And it's a statement of fact that he did not invent, he just observed because God allowed him, he downloaded wisdom in him. What am I saying with this? We can work all our lives to do something, efforts that are praiseworthy, worthwhile, meticulous, 30 years of this, 20 years of that, 50 years of, and it may not amount to much if wisdom is not with us. But we can wake up every morning to say, Lord, give me supernatural wisdom. You are the architect of the world. Help me understand it. You create the skies. You created the heavens. You created the water below, the water above. Everything is yours. You were there when it was formed. You know why it was formed. You know the purpose with which you send it on the earth, according to Job. Every lightning bolt comes down, and it's either a whip to beat people, it says, I'm not going to quote it right now because I don't have it ready. It's either a whip to beat the earth, or it's a sign of his mercy. Wow, lightning bolts are beneficial to the planet, right? They fix nitrogen in the atmosphere and other things. Wow, you know, they're not just scary little things that God somehow lost control of. A thunderstorm, right? Something happens and it just happens. Everyone commands, is at his command. Lord, give me the wisdom to understand that everything from the weather and everything from the things that are small to the things that are great are yours. Remember, Job had an issue. He wanted God to answer his personal problem. And God shows up with 80 questions of very purposeful questions that kind of say, I am in control of everything. Do you not think I'm in control of your life and of your pain? I'm in control of everything, Job. Yeah, the donkeys, I take care of those guys, you know? He wasn't minimizing Job's problem. He was saying, I'm the wise God that makes it all work. You are just observing my world. Now interpret it properly and apply it in your life. And Job said, oh, I repent. My eyes have seen him. I now understand who God is. And as a church, you may say, we know who God is, but don't we have to be constantly reminded and freshly brought to pass to say, Lord, give us the ability to choose wisdom. I speak as a guilty one. This week, knowing I would speak, I wasted so much time observing the world on the internet, reading what's going on in the world. And I'm like, I lost a lot of hours in my life understanding what's going on in the world. Now what I need is the wisdom of God, the Spirit of God, to take what I've read, help me interpret it in the context of God's final plan and perfect plan and good plan for the world, and then apply it in my life so that when he comes back, I am busy doing his work. And you guys are busy doing his work. And that's beautiful because God wants us active doing his work. Not passive, not in neutral, not revving up our engine like teenagers do, but not going anywhere, right? Apropos of teenagers, my daughter always, I always pick on her because she's a very much a source of wisdom in my life, and God uses her. So two nights ago, my parents, on Saturday, my parents went on a cruise for a week. And the night before, Colby decided to observe what a cruise would mean. So she ended up watching the Titanic. So not the movie, but the one-hour documentary of the Titanic. And she was tired, which means she was susceptible to emotions. She's 8 and a half. She observed an hour of the Titanic and what happened to that ship. She interpreted very quickly in her 8-year-old mind that Buna's going tomorrow on that ship. And her application was, Tati, what's the name of Buna's ship? I go, I don't know. Is it Titanic? I said, I sure hope not. And she was crying. That means that a child is misapplying the very facts that we observe. I can watch the same documentary and understand. I have a mature mind. We can observe our world and cry, or we can observe our world and get engaged and say, I'm ready to conquer it for Christ. May God give us the wisdom of adults with this passion and the purpose of, the passion and energy of teenagers. Why not? Colleen, we were teenagers, you know what I'm saying? With the maturity and also with the innocence of a child. I can't just deride Colby. Let me give you the positive application. See, as an adult, I care less in the sense that I know I trust the ship. I trust modern technology. I trust that they're going to go on the close to the shore. And she asked me, how close? I said, more than a mile. So they can't swim. I trust this. But as a child, she worried because she had the innocence in the heart of Buna's on a ship. And ships sink. And therefore, I should worry. And that's what we're called to do. We're called to be. Wisdom calls us to be sensitive also. To be childlike in the sense that a kingdom of God is of those like children. You know, when she sees her cousins, it could be raining outside. It could be snowing. It could be anything. She just yells. And we told her not to yell. But she yells. She screams, she opens the door, and she just loses it for a moment. She saw her loves, the cousins. It can be raining outside. She'll go barefoot because who cares, right? Who cares about the weather? You care about the person. That's how children are. When we are called to be together, imagine if we had the same attitude towards the church and towards each other and towards family and towards, hey, brother so-and-so is coming to our house. Yes, I can't wait. The problem with that is after 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 hours of children time, she has to separate, and that's where she cries again. I cannot tell her I'm trying to be responsible. You cannot cry after 8 hours of being with your cousins. Yeah, but I won't see them for a while. Who's wrong? I'm the adult. She's the child, but she has so much more heart than I do. She cries because she now misses them. Imagine if we left church tonight and every night and every day saying, oh, I can't wait to meet these guys again. It was so special tonight. I had so much, it was so beautiful at church. I can't wait to see you guys. Is it Wednesday nights when you guys have prayer? Thursday nights. I can't wait till Thursday, right? And Thursday comes with that joy, and Thursday night comes with that sorrow, and we live like that. We are living the call of wisdom, that we would apply ourselves, that we would be engaged with people, that we would not be in neutral, revving our engine, saying, oh, I'm so-and-so, he's so-and-so, boats are safe, we're okay, cousins will be here tomorrow also. You know, how boring. To her, it's the moment, and that's all that matters. And she lives the moment, I mean the positive way of looking at living the moment with the presence of her cousins. And I learned from that, and we have to be, in this sense, like children, innocent and desiring that communication, desiring that interaction with humans. Remember what wisdom says? I was there and I was rejoicing when he was making the world, and I was happy when he made the human family. I'm happy when I have a job and I interact with humans. My friend Alex now works at a restaurant. He interacts with a lot of humans when you're a waiter, right? How happy can you be and how wise can you be to interact with every human being with the love of Christ and with the happiness of serving someone food? Yeah, it's simple. Yeah, there's millions of restaurants and thousands of people frequent each restaurant each year, right? But what if you look at it differently? It's serving people. It's loving the human family like God does. is asking wisdom. We apply wisdom in our lives to say, Lord, today, who am I going to meet? And may I be wise for you in that application. Let me interpret what it means to have a job that I work with people, right? I'm a teacher. To have a job that I work with people. Some of you are pastors. Some of you guys are worship leaders. Some of you guys are other jobs when you intersect and interact with humans. How special is that? I know tomorrow's Monday. I know tomorrow can be like, oh, we got to see them again, you know, my kids again. I can grumble. I can wake up and observe how my kids on Monday morning behave. Or I can wake up and say, I'm going to be the wise one. I'm going to actually apply wisdom in my life and make Monday worth it all. Make Monday a day when, and now as I say this, I got to get ready for Monday. Make Monday the most special day for that kid's life. I see 180 kids. Imagine if my attitude is not theirs. It's different. I say, this is Monday and we are here together. I'm glad to see you all. And we approach people like wisdom does. I was happy when he made the human family. I'm going to wrap it up. And to say, I'd probably share this, I don't know if I did, but a few years ago we had that protest for the Barn Evernight. Remember that? We all got together and it was great for that purpose. And a few months later we went to the convention for the pastor's convention in Seattle, and there was about 100 pastors, and in the back there was an older gentleman that stood up, and almost with tears in his eyes, how he expressed how much joy he found at working together for a common cause as the children in Norway, saving the children. And after he said this, he said something very special. Brothers, let's protest something else so that we can be together again. He was ready to protest, and he was like in his 80s or 70s. Let's protest. It wasn't protest that he wanted. He wanted the fellowship. He just couldn't say it that way. Let's do something else. Let's find a protest. Let's find a reason to get together and work as a body, as a unit. I'm going to read one last passage, and in less than a minute, I'll be done. If we turn to John chapter 1, it's as if God said, I created everything. And now the world's a muck and there's sin and everything else. And as if God is saying, let's create something together again, you and I. And that's the call to wisdom. Let's create something together, you and I. You be on my side. Be with me. Rejoice in what I create. And that means recreating a life that's been broken by sin. A relationship that has been strained for years. Let's create something that never was. A family that never visited another family. Let's create something that never was. The reality that, you name it, fill in the blank. I want to create, God says, and will you be by my right side? That's the application. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And it goes on. I will not read the whole passage, but in the beginning was Jesus Christ, the joy of the Father. We read Saturday, we spoke when Jesus was on the mountain, and the Father says, I find my delight in him. And he found his delight in what Jesus did. And I think to have the favor of God, to have whatever God does on this planet, we would have to do what God wants to do and let him work in us. And there is a passage that says that, I'm so sorry, I forgot to read it, so I want to do it. In Proverbs it says, give me one second. For whoever finds me finds and receives favor from the Lord. That's working with wisdom. That's working with Jesus. That's allowing Jesus to live through us the wise things that he wants to do. May God give us wisdom. May God allow us to answer wisdom. And may we at the right time apply this properly in the world that we live in. Let's continue to observe the world. Sure, spend time on the news and whatever. That's fine. But then ask for wisdom to interpret every event through the light of scriptures and God's wisdom. But even more so, practically, let's not be in gear with our engines revving saying, I'm sorry, let's not be in neutral with our engines revving saying, I know it, I understand it, I'm this big in my head. Who cares? Can you apply it? Ask God for wisdom to apply it on a day-to-day basis in your walk, humbly, consistently, purposefully like Jesus was. God found favor in Jesus also in part because the way he lived his life, the way he manifested wisdom on earth. May we do that and may we be his emissaries of wisdom on this planet. Amen. Amen.